20,000 people out in the streets protesting. And it was not only a protest against the Vietnam War, but it was a protest against conditions for the Mexican year in the Southwest.
And you saw all these people just heading towards the park, music, people dancing. I remember real clearly sitting down on the grass, and that next to me was a young woman with a baby in a stroller. And that, no, I don't believe I had been down more than 30 seconds when you heard there was a disturbance in the back of the park. And before I knew it, there was tear gas, people running, screaming, and it was just really frightening.
The fact that it didn't end there at the park, but you had a riot just evolve and move down Whittier Boulevard that really lasted, as you may recall, for a couple of months afterwards. There was tension and further rioting.
I was here 25 years ago when a demonstration erupted into violence. Hello, I'm Henry Alfaro. A quarter of a century later, the same problems and concerns of this community still exist. We talked to some of the people that were here then, and today are trying to make some changes.
It was a massive demonstration of over 20,000 people from all across the Southwest. It was August 29th, 1970, in East Los Angeles. The protest was held for several reasons. One was the ongoing concern that started back in 1968, when high school students walked out of their classes, demanding better educational and employment opportunities.
I saw the teachers at Lincoln High School looking at the kids as having first and last name of manual labor, manual labor. That's where they were headed for. Girls were encouraged to take secretarial courses, and boys were encouraged to do industrial arts. I'm sure it was a thing that was going on in the entire Southwest, because no sooner did the kids walk out of here in March of 1968, when you had marches of protest for exactly the same thing in Texas, later in Denver, Colorado, and later in New Mexico. By 1969, they were having demonstrations in Chicago and Detroit. Mexicans there in those areas were concerned about what was not happening for their kids in education.
But the major concern of the Chicano moratorium was to protest the disproportionate number of Mexican Americans dying on the front lines. Out of 43,000 American soldiers killed in Vietnam through the year 1969, over 8,000 were Mexican Americans. They were all from the Southwest.
It was very difficult for many of us to protest against the war, because we had siblings that were in the service and parents that had served in World War II. And so, you know, I remember my father telling me, you know, asking, have you turned communist or something? And having to explain to him, no. And then finally for them to see that there is something wrong in this community.
The draft boards all across the country were then reaching into the African-American, Mexican-American, poor white communities, and the poor were becoming more and more cannon fodders in the war. It was hitting Mexican-Americans perhaps the hardest. So myself and other activists at that time decided, let's build a movement, when I was drafted on September 16th, Mexican Independence Day. And we just began launching a movement against the inequities of the draft.
Preparing for this demonstration, we did everything possible to cooperate with the Sheriff's Department to assure that the gathering would be a peaceful assembly.
We joined with the Brown Berets and others to form the Chicano Moratorium Committee, began holding demonstration, planning them nationwide, because it caught on like wildfire.
After that, Whittier Boulevard was never the same. I remember late that night going up Whittier Boulevard with a friend, and it looked like a war zone. And then after that, bars went up on Whittier Boulevard.
A report of looting at a liquor store at the end of Laguna Park is believed to have been what started the first confrontation between police and demonstrators in what became the largest riot since the Watts riots of 1965. More than $1 million of property was destroyed, hundreds were injured, and hundreds more were arrested. Three men were killed, and one of them was journalist Rubén Salazar. After the rioting broke out, Salazar went to the Silver Dollar Bar for a couple of drinks. To this day, events leading up to his death are not clear. One thing is certain, however, Salazar was killed instantly by a tear gas projectile fired from outside the bar by a deputy sheriff. Based on department reports, sheriff officials were after two armed men who had entered the Silver Dollar Bar on Whittier Boulevard. But later, that report turned out to be inaccurate.
This is the Silver Dollar Bar. It's located on Whittier Boulevard here in East Los Angeles. This is the place where the life of one of the community's greatest heroes was cut short. And it happened 25 years ago.
You know, I'd escaped death in Vietnam trenches. A massacre at Tlatelolco. But who's to say I'd still be alive today?
It's been a quarter of a century now that journalist Ruben Salazar was killed on August 29th by a sheriff's tear gas projectile. The questions that surround his death and the spirit of the man are still fresh in the minds and the hearts of those that remember him.
The combination of influential positions he had as news director at KMEX, the biggest, and, well, in those days the only, but it was the most important source of news for the Latino community, and a columnist for the Times, I said, this man is irreplaceable.
Ruben was always concerned with how is this situation here affecting the common man, the people in the street, the working people, the youth. And he did it in Cuba, he did it in Mexico City, he did it in Vietnam.
He was a professional reporter who happened to be of Mexican-American background, which meant that he had some insights and connections in the Mexican-American community, and hence his reporting about Mexican-American affairs in the early 60s and then later in the late 60s was very important. But I think people have to recall that he was first and foremost a professional correspondent and reporter, and he did an outstanding job as such. In late 1968, Ruben Salazar was asked by the LA Times to return to Los Angeles. This is something that he did not particularly welcome. He enjoyed being a foreign correspondent. He enjoyed having the perks of being the bureau chief in Mexico City. But he was asked to come back because of developments in Los Angeles, specifically the fact that the LA Times was caught off guard with the LA school so-called blowouts or walkouts in the spring of 1968, when thousands of young Chicanos walked out of the schools in East Los Angeles to protest inferior education.
UC Santa Barbara history professor Mario Garcia is the author of a new book on Ruben Salazar. The book includes a collection of Salazar's writings from 1955 to 1970.
They had no one that they could really use to cover the growing frustration and protest in the Mexican community in Los Angeles and throughout the Southwest, what ultimately is referred to as the Chicano movement. So they turned to Salazar once again, you know, to kind of rescue them.
He began writing some of his very heavy articles about what Chicanismo was, what it was to be a Chicano, and the concerns about the community.
Who is a Chicano, and what is it the Chicanos want? February 6, 1970. A Chicano is a Mexican-American with a non-Anglo image of himself. He resents being told Columbus discovered America when the Chicano's ancestors, the Mayans and the Aztecs, founded highly sophisticated civilizations centuries before Spain financed the Italian explorer's trip to the New World.
I'm only advocating the Mexican-American community, just like the general media is advocating, really, our economy, our country, our way of life. So I'm just advocating a community within a community, which, by the way, the general community has totally ignored. And so someone must advocate that.
I think he was a brave, brave man at that time. He was a vanguard. He was somebody who was, today you go to the Times, there's 30, 40 Latino Chicano reporters. I mean, he was the only one. I mean, he had to be awful lonesome at that time. And especially the fact that he didn't duck the issues. He was covering East LA. He was covering the Chicano movement. He was covering Mexican-American politics.
He never shied away from terrible criticism. In fact, he delighted in it because he says, I got them thinking. And I'll never forget him saying, he said, they're mad because I got them thinking.
He was doing things that nowadays we take for granted. You know, criticizing police tactics. Nowadays, it's routine. Back then, 25 years ago, nobody did that. And so, to that degree, I know that there were people not sorry that he died. Whether they actually assassinated him, I still have my doubts. But I'll be honest, as I say, I'll probably never know to my satisfaction one way or the other. I don't know if anybody can.
In July of 1970, he covered the killing of two Chicano youths, the Sanchez brothers, by the LA police, who literally burst into the apartment of these two brothers, and shot them to death. They later claimed that they were there because of the sense that they might be involved in drug trafficking. This was never proved. Salazar exposed this on Channel 34. This had never been done before, this kind of showing on television the issue of police abuse, especially with respect to the Chicano community.
There were three of us had lunch with him on the Wednesday before. He told us that he was being followed. He told us that he wanted us to know because I was a federal official and that he felt intimidated.
He had a sense that he had angered the police. He had a sense that he was being pursued and followed by the police. And days before the moratorium, he expressed to people that he felt that there was going to be violence at the moratorium, not the violence created by the demonstrators, the people who would march against the Vietnam War, but by the police itself. And so he expressed some sense of some problems happening.
The last time I saw him was when he was in the middle of the park and he had his crew. They were trying to focus upon what was happening, but Rubin was trying to get some sheriff or some police captain or sergeant to come and be interviewed. He wanted to ask him, why is this happening?
All of Rubén Salazar's fears came true. The demonstration erupted into violence, and his life was taken away by the end of that day. He was only 42 years old.
I was shocked. I couldn't even talk. When a man tells you on Wednesday that people are following him, and on Saturday he's accidentally killed, was I shocked. Several of us sat up and talked about it most of the night, and I couldn't call his wife till in the morning. I mean, I didn't have, you know, because I was afraid that if I called her, she would tell me it was true.
Our stations took the brunt of it. They threw Molotov cocktails and things at, so we had to put armed guards at our station and during that period.
The inquest, which followed shortly thereafter, which ran for some 13 days, was televised in Los Angeles, proved to be, it lacked substance. It simply was did not deal with the main issue of why Rubén Salazar was killed. Why had the county sheriff showed up? Why had they shot these missiles into the Silver Dollar Cafe? Why had they left the body in there for 2 hours before any official went in? All of these things remain unanswered.
I think it was just a cover-up. I think it was just they had to go through a process. They had to have a grand jury inquiry, and nobody was going to believe anybody but the police. And it was a situation where our community was voiceless.
And ask you if you are familiar with this weapon.
A coroner's inquest heard testimony from 61 witnesses. Four of the seven jurors ruled that Salazar had died at the hands of another. Three jurors concluded that his killing was an accident. No charges were filed against the deputy who fired the fatal projectile. The U.S. Justice Department also said they investigated the case and found no grounds for criminal charges. Later, Salazar's widow won a $700,000 settlement for the family against the county. The deputy sheriff had used the gun against all department regulations.
I know this paper, aiming at this 25th anniversary, the Times filed some Freedom of Information Act requests with the Federal Bureau of Investigation, with the CIA, to see if they had files on Salazar. We've determined that they still do, and that they're still secret. So obviously, there's still work to be done.
And here's to you, Rubén Salazar, the Chicano martyr.
A play commemorating the Chicano moratorium and Rubén Salazar is being performed now at Plaza de la Raza in Lincoln Heights. Enrique Castillo is one of the writers.
Fortunately, I was able to speak with Sally, his wife, before she passed away. She helped us tremendously. Ironically, one of the last things he said to her was, I've made it through so much, through Vietnam and Mexico City. Watch me get killed in a bar in East LA with a drink in my hand. And we thought, when she said that, we all fell silent, because it was very chilling.
About 1,000 Latinos got together on the anniversary of the Chicano moratorium. To commemorate that day, they marched the route, taken back then from Belvedere Park to what is now called Rubén Salazar Park.